appear when days dim. God, you are my God, and I will trust in you and not be shaken. Lord, the peace bring you. I step the spirit within me to rest in you.
Is it time to commence to begin to start? Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Faith Baptist Church. If somebody out in the lobby would close those doors so that light is not shining in and we can hear well. First of all, today after the morning service is Mike Lucan's memorial service, and you're all invited for that. And immediately afterwards, there will be a fellowship meal. You're all invited to stay for that as well. This Wednesday night, we'll be talking about Abraham and Isaac and our continued series in the book of Genesis. It'll be the story of when Abraham offered up Isaac. Good Friday night, 6:30 p.m., we're having a communion service here Friday at 6:30 for Good Friday. Then the sunrise service at 7 a.m. will be outside around the cross fountain, and then there's a nice hot breakfast right after that. Then the morning worship is at 10 a.m. That's next Sunday. It's Easter. I was going through some names this morning. We had one of our members passed away a couple of weeks ago, Deb Riceboro. She was out in the lobby. She was a greeter, and she was there most Sundays greeting people. She passed away a couple of weeks ago. Along with that, we've had Mike Lukens and Jim Hawkins and Mo Bowman and Roxanne Weborg and Steve Cadlin all in this less than a year. And a number of you have lost parents in the last year, and it just seems like there's been a lot of deaths because so many of us haven't returned to services yet from COVID-19. Many are watching online, and they will say they will be here as soon as COVID passes. They'll be back with us. But there's an absence, and it's a sadness. And I hope you will mark the times we have with each other. We have no guarantees of tomorrow. And today, when we'll be honoring Mike, we'll certainly keep that in mind. One of our former members, Chris Kennedy, is recovering from COVID-19. He was here this week. He's involved in our Man of Ministry, and he has a few more months of recovery. Another former member, Gina Tasso, who is now Gina Mann, she married Mike Mann. They both have COVID. She is in a coma with a ventilator, but they hope to take her off the ventilator this week. I spoke to Mike yesterday. And they watch on live stream, and they would like to be here with us, but they can't. But Mike will be going home this week, so if you'd pray for Mike and Gina Mann. For Renee Pagan, one of our church members who is also a worker at Doctors Hospital on the front lines, along with all of the nurses and physicians we have who are on the front lines facing COVID exposure every day, and just the stress of living and working in a hospital environment, if you'd please pray for Renee. My dad, good news about him. I saw him yesterday, and he's off all medication completely, and his mind is clear. He's energetic. He's talkative. He doesn't weigh very much, but he's in real good spirits, and he wanted to make sure he said hello to all of you, and he hopes to be with us in one of the Easter services. And then Dan Morgan, I was going to pray for him, but he's here this morning, right down here in the front, but please keep him in prayer as he's recovering. And then for our nation, as we go through a continual reenactment of shootings, it seems like every weekend now there's a shooting somewhere. Our country is suffering from great distrust, unrest, possibly even deception, and of course just discord everywhere. And hopefully the church can rise up and be salt and light to a culture that desperately needs truth and stability. And we have it in our faith, we have it in God, we have it in His Word. And we need to make sure that we play that role in our nation. Today is Palm Sunday. And on Palm Sunday, when Christ entered into Jerusalem, the crowd gathered and they cheered great cries of praise and worship and adoration. But those cries were all empty because a week later they're yelling out, "Crucify him." So it's a good reminder to us to make sure that we don't fulfill Isaiah's prophetic observation that Jesus quoted. And he said, "They praise me with their lips," or "they worship me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." So when we worship today, let's make sure that our hearts are in tune with our lips and we are engaged in what we sing and say as we worship the Lord. Let me ask you to please stand together and we will pray and begin this morning's musical portion of the worship before we go into 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faithfulness to us. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for this day that we recognize and remember Christ's entry into Jerusalem, that he knew full well when he went in there what was going to happen in that week. But he did so with courage and faith and trust and obedience to you, knowing that he would pay for the sins of all mankind. And I pray today that as we lift our voices in praise, that we will do so with our hearts engaged, with our lips and minds, that it'll be sincere and genuine. We can never be perfect. We can never bring to you sinless hearts, but we can have hearts that are submitted to you and worship and adoration. Help us to sing these songs wholeheartedly. We pray for our nation, our president, our vice president, members of Congress, those in law enforcement, fire and rescue, and our governors and state legislators. Father, we pray for the church, that that mix of leadership in this country will prevent this nation from going over the edge of moral sanity and philosophical wisdom, that instead we will trust in you, follow you, honor you, revere you, and love one another. And may the Church of Jesus Christ be the salt and light you've called us to be. And may we do our part here as a local church. May we speak truth. We pray that you'll be honored and pleased by what comes out of our mouths today and what is in our hearts as we sing to you, give to you, pray to you, and then listen to your word. For we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Clouds with fire, the whole
shakes, the whole earth shakes, yeah. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people see, the people see. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the darkness, we were waiting without hope. without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, oh, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lifts a flame, now this gospel truth of old shall not yield and shall not faint. For His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Opportunity to praise your name. We thank you for being able to fellowship together as a congregation, and we just ask that you would take your word, that you would anoint it, and you would give us ears to hear and apply it to our lives. And we thank you again for this time to worship together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, and please be seated. We are in our study of Paul's letters to the Thessalonians, Thessalonians 1 and Thessalonians 2. We are in part 6 today, chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians. Turn there in your Bibles if you would, or on your phones or on your iPad, verses 13 through 18. Today is, the topic is a spectacular, fantastical, exciting topic, but also divisive, controversial, and many people dismiss it. Some might over-sensationalize it, even if that's even possible. But it's something that you and I should be aware of because it is in Scripture. Just as the Old Testament promise of the Messiah's arrival contained two separate events, his birth as a baby and then his return as the king, the New Testament promise of the Messiah's return also contains two separate events, the rapture of the church and the second coming of Jesus Christ. So in 2 Thessalonians, when Paul talks about it, and he brings it up again in his next letter, he calls the rapture our gathering to him, and he calls the return of Christ that day. So this section today, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, was written to clear up three misunderstandings that this early group of believers had about Christ's return, and they're similar to what we have today. Number one, some thought you had to be alive when Jesus came back to retrieve his bride, or you wouldn't be taken to heaven. Some thought that if you died before Jesus came to get his bride, you would still be taken, but you'd be taken up in a second class, sort of second tier kind of state. And the third misunderstanding was they feared they had missed the rapture altogether. It had already occurred, and they were now in the great tribulation, and so they were left to face the wrath of God when Christ comes back. So it was three fears. And it was this was the early embryonic church. Paul had taught them about this as he refers to it in his letter that I've already taught this to you before. But fear and persecution had caused them to wonder and to doubt, did they misunderstand? It's the kind of uncertainty you and I don't have to deal with yet because we don't have a government that is aimed at silencing us just yet. They haven't criminalized us just yet. They haven't put us as a target. But you can see those clouds gathering. And it might be social at first. It might be removal from social media or removal from internet live streaming and access through the computer. But the day is coming when our message will be so irritating to the world and considered to be such hate speech and so anti-state that they are going to marginalize us. And history has shown once you're marginalized, you're persecuted. I wonder then, what will we think? What did believers in Nazi Germany think and in Russia and in China when the government cracked down on them and arrested them and even executed some of them, put them in prison? Did they wonder, are we in the Great Tribulation? Do some of them wonder today? Because there are people today who live in situations where you could say that sounds like the tribulation because they cannot practice their faith. So what is this thing called the rapture that many people laugh at, many people dismiss, many people say it's not a valid belief? What is it? The rapture is a supernatural event in which all believers, those who've died and those who are still alive, are instantly taken to heaven to be with Christ and reunited with one another. And if you're writing this down, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 54, and then John 14:1-3. Those three passages describe this event. And at the end of the message, we're going to show you how this event is so different than the second coming that it has to be a distinct event. So why is this relevant to you and me in 2021? With all that's going on, why is the rapture relevant to discuss in church? It is because it's a scriptural event. It's in the Bible. And it's referenced by Jesus, and it's referenced by Paul, and it's referenced both times to provide comfort to believers in a hostile world. Our world is definitely shifting towards hostility towards people of faith. Are we ready for that? Well, one of the comforts we will have is knowing this truth of the rapture. Number two, although there are numerous things that the Bible says must happen before Christ comes back that haven't happened yet, there are no prerequisite signs of the rapture. There is nothing that has to happen that we know of before the rapture. That means the rapture could happen today. That's why it's relevant. because it was given to us by Christ and Paul as a comforting truth, and because it could happen today. So the question then is, are we ready? So now detractors claim that the rapture is not found in Scripture and was only recently invented in the 1820s. And I want to address that quickly because I know some of you often hear that. Or if you type in the rapture in Google, those things are going to come up first. They say it was invented by some questionable Pentecostals and then popularized by anti-science, anti-intellectual, and sensational evangelicals. Well, the recent history of it is, in the 1820s to the 1870s, a man named Edward Irving, who was a Scottish Presbyterian clergy member, he converted to Pentecostalism. A young woman in his church, Margaret MacDonald, she was 15 years old, she had these visions. And the two of them together presented to their church this idea that Christ was going to rapture the church out before the tribulation. Well, John Darby, who was an Irish member of the Church of England, he changed then and maybe even founded the Plymouth Brethren. He then taught that same principle. And then C.I. Schofield picked it up in the early 1920s. It became part of the Schofield Bible, of the notes in the Schofield Bible, which all independent, fundamental, Bible-believing, friendly, soul-winning Baptists used back in the 70s. We all use the Schofield Bible. And then Hal Lindsey in the 1970s wrote The Late Great Planet Earth, and that made it a critical issue for everybody to address. And then Tim LaHaye's series, Left Behind, that began in the 90s and went into the early 2000s, that sort of popularized it. Then the movies came out, Left Behind. Well, that's the immediate history of the concept of the rapture, but it really predates that. But let's say it didn't. Don't dismiss a doctrinal assertion because of a seemingly recent origin or because of someone of a questionable line of theology asserts that it's true. Salvation by faith alone, apart from works, seemed incredibly new in 1517, and its source was a disgruntled Catholic monk, and it was dismissed as a heretical doctrine. It is the very foundation of our faith. Baptism by immersion appeared to be a new belief in the 1600s, but it was promoted by rebellious Anabaptists, which means baptizing again. And the idea that Israel would be ever become a nation again was just impossible. And it was a nefarious thought until 1948. Now, I bring all those up because all of those were taught in the Bible for millennia. They only became maybe popularized or discussed in certain generations, but they are all in Scripture. So I want to let you know that the rapture is not just an invention of, quote, crazy Pentecostals who've had visions and then popularized by Schofield and sensational, shallow-minded evangelicals or crazy dispensationalists or Bible literalists. The rapture is in the Word of God. And because it's in the Word of God, it was not just taught by the early church. It was also taught all the way back to Paul. So those who say the rapture was never even thought of until the 1820s just don't know church history or have looked open-mindedly at Scripture. In 306 to 373 A.D., in the life of Ephraim, he was a bishop in Nisibis, Syria. He wrote this, "We ought to understand, my brothers, what is imminent. Why do we not reject every care of earthly actions and prepare ourselves for the meeting of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that he may draw us from the confusion which is overwhelming the world? Believe me, dearest brothers, because the coming of the Lord is nigh, all the saints and elects of God are gathered prior to the tribulation that is to come and are taken to the Lord, lest they see the confusion that is to overwhelm the world." That he's talking about the rapture, and this is in the 4th century. In the 200s, Cyprian, who was martyred, he was the bishop of Carthage. He said, "Do you not give God thanks that by an early departure you are taken away and delivered from the shipwrecks and disasters that are imminent? Let us greet the day which snatches us hence and sets us free from the snares of the world and restores us to paradise and the kingdom. Cyprian is writing about the rapture. Then in the 100s, Irenaeus. He was a martyr. Irenaeus was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a personal disciple of John, who wrote the book of Revelation. And Irenaeus's doctrinal treatise called Against Heresies, one of the most important prophetic writings of the early church, he wrote there would be a seven-year tribulation preceded by the rapture and then followed by the literal return of Christ to the world for the thousand-year reign on earth. So that's going back in church history in the earliest days to Paul, who in 51 AD wrote today's passage. So let's look at today's passage so we can see what was Paul trying to say. He was clarifying his previous teachings about Christ's return because the people were being traumatized by the Roman government and the Greek culture and the Roman culture all attacking the church. So in this passage today, he's going to first address the concerns about those who die before the gathering and those who are still alive at the time of the gathering. So let's read the passage. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. Now the word asleep is used three times in that passage, and it gives you an indication of the way God sees the death of a believer. The believer's spirits are alive in the presence of the Lord, Paul has told us. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So the spirit is still alive, but the bodies are asleep on or in the earth. And this word hope, this hope that we can have, it's not a wish. It's an assured certainty of something that is yet to be realized. So this hope that Paul is referring to is a guaranteed promise that has just not yet happened, but it is going to happen. Then he made that comment, sorrow as others who have no hope. Today we're doing a memorial service, and it's a celebration of a great saints going home to be with the Lord, but there is sorrow attached to it, to all those who loved Mike and missed the interaction with him. There is a sorrow. Paul is not dismissing sorrow among believers when a loved one dies, but the genuine sorrow felt by a believer, which can be overwhelming sometimes and profound, is tempered by the assurance of a reunion in heaven. What Paul is saying is unbelievers have no such assurance. So he said, when you sorrow, you don't sorrow in the way unbelievers sorrow because they have no guarantee of a reunion. We do. And he's referring to the rapture. So this is a comforting passage for us. And the series that we're doing, it was just happens to fall on this day. It's not intended to be with Mike's memorial service or even to be on Palm Sunday, but it's attached to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's the illustration Paul uses to show you how miraculous this event is. In modern Christianity, we become so intellectual and academic and philosophical, we like to dismiss the miraculous, or we substitute the miraculous for little plastic bottles of spring water that if you pay $50, you can get it and get a miracle. We simplify miracles for something immediate. But the faith in and of itself is miraculous. That we were dead and we're now alive. That we were sinners and now we're redeemed. And we are justified. And we were going to hell and now we're going to heaven. That we were a child of the devil. We're a child of God. Jesus' words. There's a miraculous change that happens to you and me because the faith is a miraculous truth. The rapture follows that same vein. So he says, even so, God will bring with him. The even so is a reference to that previous statement, just as God raised Jesus from the dead. So what Paul is saying is that just like God did that, he's going to raise those who are asleep. It's the same miraculous power God is going to implement on those who have fallen asleep. So he's saying to these believers who are afraid that their loved ones have missed out because they didn't survive long enough, he's saying, don't worry. The same God who raised Jesus will raise them up too. And it's interesting that a believer's death is described as sleep, but Christ's death is referred to as death because he died that we might have life. And then he makes this comment, by no means will precede those who are asleep. Those who are alive and remain will by no means, under any circumstances, under any criteria, precede or be more preeminent than those who are asleep. So believers who have died will not be second-tier citizens in heaven, will not miss out on anything, and will not even be secondary in the rapture. They actually go first. So now he describes it in verse 16. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And I'm going to save that last phrase to the end because it's something we often overlook. The Lord himself. So this is a direct and in-person, personal act of Christ to retrieve his bride. He does not dispatch an angel to do this. An archangel doesn't do it. He does it himself. Jesus describes that in John 14, 1 through 3. He said, if I go to my Father's house, I will come again to retrieve you to myself. And he's portraying that in the Jewish wedding tradition of the day, where the groom would leave, prepare a place, and come back unannounced until that moment. He's coming back for his bride, and she's to be ready, and then he would take her back to his Father's house. That's the image he's saying or presenting in John 14. Christ will do it himself. In Matthew 24, where the Bible says the angels call the elect from the four winds of heaven, that's talking about the second coming, not the rapture. So the Lord himself will descend from heaven. This is his first visit to earth after his ascension, and it will transpire in the same fashion as his ascension, which is why in Acts chapter 1, when Jesus rose up into heaven after his resurrection, and they 500 believers were there, and they watched him rise up into heaven, and their jaws sort of drop, and their heads are looking up, and two angels appear and say, men of Galilee and Jerusalem, believers, why are you looking up into heaven? And astonishment. Jesus is going to come back the same way you just saw him leave, which was a supernatural, miraculous event going into heaven. He's going to come down from it, but with a shout. And the Greek word is kalousama, and it means a victorious battle cry to assemble all the saints. He himself is going to initiate a shout. It's a battle cry to all the saints resurrected and all those he's about to rapture, which we'll see what that word means in a minute. For those of you who've ever been to a professional or maybe a major college sporting event and you've seen the introduction of the team or the entry of the team onto the field, they stir you up and they crank you up with all sorts of excitement, and then it's announced, here they are, and they'll say the team name. And then, boom, they'll come crashing through whatever they come crashing through to run on the field. And everybody just goes crazy. That's the sports world. In the ancient world, everything was military-minded. Everything was related to a monarchy. A dignitary presented himself. And it was done with a shout. Well, war began with this battle cry. This is Christ coming back in battle form, the Bible tells us in Revelation. So his shout is a victorious cry to the group behind him, which are the resurrected saints and the saints that will be raptured, with the voice of the archangel. So his shout is accompanied by an archangel's call. It doesn't say the archangel. It's actually, there's no definite article. It's an archangel. So there must be more than one, but a high-ranking angel echoes the call of the Lord. And it's possible that's because that's assembling the angels. With the trumpet of God. So this is a royal and official means of announcing an arrival. A regal announcement and a military call to arms. So he's presenting Christ's return in the greatest, most glorious protocol you can imagine. It's the appearance of the groom to retrieve his bride, preparing for that day when he will come back as the conquering king. The dead in Christ will rise first. So all those names we just read at the start of the service, they are all going to rise before you and I if it happened today. And that doesn't mean they're going to zip up in the heavens and we're going to see something happen and wait around for a few hours, then we go. It's all instantaneous. But Paul wanted them to know, no, they're going to be equal. They're going to rise before we go. Well, how do they rise? Jesus told us how in John chapter 6. All he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. Everyone who believes in me may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up that last day. No one can come to me unless the Father draws him, and I will raise him up that last day. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. It is Jesus' call that raises the dead at this moment of his return. This is an incredible, you can't over-sensationalize this. You can only make it superficial. And you can only make it spectacular. But you cannot over-sensationalize this amazing event in world history that's going to be the most amazing event up to that time. The only one that will be greater will be 7 years later when Christ comes back. Jesus raises the dead at that time. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up. So the living are not resurrected. You can't be resurrected if you haven't died. The living are changed. So there are two miracles in this gathering. The regeneration of dead and decaying, or maybe even dust bodies, and the complete transformation of living bodies. So somehow by the time we get up to heaven to see Jesus, we and the dead are all alike. Their bodies are resurrected and we are completely transformed. There's no way to explain that. There's no way to understand it. Paul described it in 1 Corinthians 15. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For that trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. Now that word caught up, we shall all be caught up, it's the word harpazo in Greek. And it means to be abruptly snatched away. In the Latin Vulgate, harpazo is translated rapturo, from the Latin word rapio. The English word rapture is a transliteration or translation of the word rapturo. So you'll often have somebody say, rapture isn't even in the Bible. Well, there are no English words in the Bible because the Bible was written in Greek and Hebrew. Everything that we see in the English Bible is a translation. The words were chosen, caught up, but you could have easily have put the words raptured, snatched away, and in modern vernacular, teleported or beamed up. You could use any word to describe this snatching away. The word Christ isn't in the Bible, but the word Christos is. The word church is not in the Bible, but the word ecclesia is. The word Bible is not even in the Bible, but logos tou theou is, which means the word of God, or graphe, which means scripture. So those who say rapture is not even in the Bible are not incorporating the language aspect of where the word comes from. The word rapture actually is in the Bible. It's the word harpazo, which means to be caught up, snatched away quickly, and the word rapture means to be caught up. So this event is an amazing, supernatural, miraculous event that there's no reason for you to bow your head in shame that you believe, as if you're a crazy evangelical, because you believe this amazing event is going to happen. There's nothing to be ashamed about that. Then Paul says, to meet in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and thus shall we always be with the Lord. So we're caught up together, but for the purpose of being reunited with and joined to the Lord. That word harpazo, caught up, in Greek language and culture, often meant to steal, to snatch away unannounced, to pickpocket, to steal something from somebody when they don't want you to take it. That's the image of this snatching away. We're going to be taken without warning. The world won't even know it happened until they reach in their pocket to get their wallet and realize it's gone. And that wallet will be the devastation of all the things that raptured believers were doing when they were suddenly taken away. But it'll be too late. This is the amazing phrase that I think we often overlook. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. The message of the rapture is not fear, it's comfort. It should make you and I just breathe a little easier. Not that we're never going to suffer, but that we are never going to experience the wrath of God or the wrath of Satan during the tribulation. We will be removed. That's a comfort to us. Back in the 70s, when I first heard about the rapture and all the churches I went to, it was never presented as a comfort. It was presented as an evangelical tool of fear. And so the idea was, if you don't get saved right now and the rapture happens tonight, not only will you be left behind, but you have no chance at all to ever get saved again. And people's eyes, of course, back then people believed the Bible, and you could talk and say the Bible says, and it had import back then. But it was a tool of fear. It is given to us. It's not a message to the world. It's a message to believers to hold on. Be comforted. Realize that your victory is assured no matter how bad the world gets. What you and I are being salvaged from or saved from or rescued from is the wrath of God. The wrath of God that will be revealed 7 years later, the Bible says, when even the greatest kings and warriors cry out to the rocks to fall on them, because who can withstand the wrath of the Lamb? So here's some distinctions. The harpazo rapturo rapture is quite different than the account of Christ's return that Jesus himself gives and John gives. If you have a moment to write these down, Matthew 24, 9 through 31, Revelation 19, 11 through 21, 1 Thessalonians 4, the whole chapter, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and 2, John 14, 1 through 3, and Revelation 6 and 20, those verses portray two events. And I want you to see the differences between the two so you will know these really are two separate events. They are not the same event smashed together. They are completely different. Here's the differences. From those passages, we see in the rapture, Christ comes for his own in the rapture. Christ comes with his own at the second coming. Christ stops above the earth at the rapture. But Christ steps on the Mount of Olives in the second coming, and it splits in two. Only believers see Christ at the rapture in this very warm family reunion. But everyone sees Christ at his return, and it's not a reunion, it's a conquest. The Great Tribulation follows the rapture, and we'll see that in the next few weeks in Thessalonians. The Great Tribulation precedes the return of Christ. Christ comes at the end of the tribulation, but the rapture happens before the Great Tribulation, which we've learned in the past is 7 years long. Believers escape God's wrath through the rapture, but believers join in God's wrath in Christ's return. That great army on white horses following Christ when he comes back and he slays the nations with the word of his mouth, we are the ones that are behind him, joining him in his great conquest. In the Bible, Satan is very active after the rapture for 7 years, but Satan is tightly bound in the bottomless pit after the return of Christ. Two complete different portrayals. Believers begin their reunion at the rapture. So shall we always be with the Lord from that point on. But believers begin their reign on earth at the return of Christ. Two different outcomes. There are no signs indicating when the rapture is near, but there are numerous signs that indicate when Christ's return is near. So I say this to you, I don't know what the future holds for us in our nation. I am concerned when I see legislation being handed down that eliminates, with the stroke of a pen, individual rights. And I see that even the government doesn't have to do it, but social media empires can silence free speech. That there are some dark days coming. The party celebration, fun, be all you can be Christian faith that is so popular might not be the faith that survives the onslaught that's coming. What will survive is a complete, unadulterated faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and His promise to us and belief in the Word of God. Not that we're going to get everything we want and have every health we need and have every possession we want to have and have every ambition and dream if we can claim it and believe it enough. That's not biblical faith. Biblical faith is, while I'm being taken to the lion's den, when I'm thrown into the fiery furnace, when I'm brought before the king, when I'm tied to a stake, when I'm standing in front of a firing squad, those are the moments that you'll know, do I have biblical faith or am I living a fantasy life of abundance? And we might not know till that time will our faith withstand. But Paul said to these believers, don't worry. Be comforted. You will never feel the wrath of God. But he did tell them, you are going to feel the wrath of man, but Jesus will always be with you, and he will deliver you, and you'll be with him forever. That was a church like us. We've had 6 or 7 deaths in this year. This was a church in Thessalonica that was experiencing death and trauma because the Roman government was persecuting them. He could not tell them, oh, Rome's going to be overthrown. Don't worry about it. That was 300 years away. He couldn't tell them, they're not going to be able to hurt your body because God's going to protect your body. What he told them was, your soul is secure. Even if you die and you're in the grave, when Jesus comes back, he'll raise you up. If you're alive when he comes back, he'll snatch you up. Either way, no one will be left behind who is a believer in Jesus Christ. There might be a time coming. You and I are going to need to know that. And Jesus said this in Matthew, therefore, be you also ready, for the Son of Man comes at an hour you do not expect. I hope you're encouraged by the truth of the rapture. But more than that rapture, that you're encouraged by the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who when he comes back for us like that, is coming as a groom to retrieve his bride. And I've done many, many weddings, and I always like to look at the groom when the bride first shows up, particularly if he hasn't seen her all day. And even more so if they haven't lived together prior to the wedding. When he sees her face and sees that white outfit, often tears stream down the man's face, or they sort of freeze and just look. And they're looking at the woman's eyes, hoping to get some kind of, get me through this, look at me and smile, get me through this moment. It's a beautiful, tender moment before they get together and make that vow. That is the picture Christ gave when he said, this is how this is going to happen. I'm going to come with all my buddies and blow the horns, and I'm coming to get you, and I will bring you to myself. It is the romance of the gospel. It's not a sensual romance. It's a romance of love and relationship and fellowship, because we are all the children of God. And in the most intimate way we can understand, the Bible tells us we will be the bride of Christ. That's the great comfort of our faith, that it's not just some creed we believe. We believe in a person who has redeemed us and saved us and will come back for us. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we ask you to help each one of us ponder these thoughts today. And as it appears to us, at least in America, that our world is growing more hostile. There are believers all around the world today whose worlds are already hostile. They've already been imprisoned. They've already been silenced. They've already been beaten. They've already had loved ones executed. And that's been going on for centuries. But for us in America, we're just starting to see that cloud gather, the storm getting near. Father, help us not to respond with fear, but with faith. Help us to have the same faith that all the martyrs throughout all history have had, where they were able to say, if I perish, I perish. And even if God doesn't deliver me, I will not bow. Or as Daniel, who told not to pray, prayed three times with his door and his window swung wide open. Help us to have courage and faith, knowing that you will keep your promise, even when it seems impossible. Even when Christianity has lost its clout in our culture, that you never lose yours and you will bring us to yourself. And Father, I pray if there's anybody here today, either watching on live stream or in an auditorium, who has never personally responded to the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they will see the majestic beauty of this promise and that it is available to them through faith as they acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord. May you draw them to that decision today. Let me ask you to remain with your heads bowed and eyes closed so that everybody has just a moment of privacy. If anything in this message particularly struck your heart, that you can talk to the Lord about it. If you don't know that he'd come back for you, if he's drawing you right now, you can respond, yes, Lord, I believe, and I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Not that he exists, but that he is your Lord, that you are submitting to him. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The promise of the rapture and the home in heaven is granted by God's grace through our response of faith because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I hope that you are a believer today. Father, work your will in each one of our hearts and lives, and may your Spirit enliven us and enlighten us, and then use us as salt and light in our culture. And for all those who are on that precipice of belief, may you allow them to jump into your arms and acknowledge your love for them that caused you to send your son Jesus to die for them. And they will acknowledge him today, receive him, and confess him as Lord. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank each one of you for coming today and remind you that Friday night at 6:30 we'll have our Good Friday communion service, sunrise service at 7 o'clock out there around the cross fountain. There'll be some nice chairs for you to sit in. It's always a nice, cool way to start the morning. And then we'll have a delicious hot breakfast afterwards. Then the morning service will be in here at 10 o'clock. It is a dramatic musical presentation with some good readings and a short exhortation from Scripture about Easter that we will leave marveling at our risen Savior. That's all this weekend. And as you go between now and Sunday, try to take a moment each day this week to consider the importance and the significance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ to your life. Those songs we sang at the start of the service, can we sing those in full, wholehearted joy that he is coming and we do love him? Think about that at least one day, one time every day this week as we get closer to Easter. And in about 5 or 10 minutes, we will begin the memorial service for Mike Lukens. You're welcome to go out and to the lobby and freshen up, then come back in, and we'll commence that service in just a few minutes. Let's all please stand together. And we'll be dismissed in prayer. Father, we thank you for each one who has attended today and all those who are watching on live stream. And we do pray that your Spirit will encourage us, edify us, prepare us, and then use us and fill us full of joy and confidence and grace and peace and boldness and a sense of a call from you to be salt and light in a dark and dying world. May you bless each person who's here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you next Sunday.